Half-a-day students, I am Governor Lou Leon Guerrero. You all have been through a year of big changes. We've had to adapt and make big changes to keep our families and our island safe. But with change comes opportunity and a chance to try new things like PBS University. While Lieutenant Governor Josh Tenorio and I will continue to do our part to keep our island safe, you students have a part to play as well. Your part is to keep learning and to keep up with your lessons. That's why I am happy to see you here ready to learn with PBS University. PBS University is a way to bring a continuous educational curriculum to you while you stay safe at home during this time. To help you keep up with your studies, we asked our friends at PBS Guam and the Guam Department of Education to put together this episode. Thank you for doing your part and have a great lesson.
PBS University is a program by PBS Guam and the Guam Department of Education in conjunction with public school teachers. These lessons are created to provide both parents and students with a unique educational experience while helping students to continue learning at home. PBS University, next on PBS Guam.
1, 2, 3, 4!
Come along, let's sing a song, we'll have a great adventure. We'll have a great adventure.
Numbers,
letters,
science things, all that we can do. Help you deal with how you feel. Share with us too.
It's super cool and just like school.
Our awesome learning adventures. So grab a friend, the fun will end. Our awesome learning adventures. Awesome learning adventures.
Annyeonghaseyo, annyeonghaseyo, annyeonghaseyo.
Welcome to PBS University, first and second grade literacy with me, your teacher, Mrs. Pegarito. Did you know that 안녕하세요 means hello in Korean? You know, sometimes learning a new language makes me a little nervous. Let's try saying hello in Korean together. 안녕하세요. Great job! Sometimes trying food from another culture makes me feel a little nervous too. You want to know what I do when I feel a little nervous trying something new? I remember that everybody is different, and the foods we eat are different too. And that's what makes this world so special. I also have with me ingredients for a delicious Korean dish. Would you like to see what's inside this pot? Take a look! Vegetables! The story we're reading today is called Beep Bim Bop. Say it with me. Beep Bim Bop. Great job! Now you try saying it on your own. Awesome! Are you ready for our read aloud? I can't hear you! I said, are you ready for a read aloud? Great! Let's go on a reading adventure!
Bibim Bop by Linda Sue Park. Illustrated by Hobake Lee. To Jackson and Margaret. And for everyone who loves Korean food. Hey! That's me! I love Korean food! Almost time for supper! Rushing to the store. Mama buys the groceries. More, Mama, more! Hurry, Mama, hurry! Gotta shop, shop, shop! Hungry, hungry, hungry! It's your turn now! For some, let's read this!
Beep, bin, bop!
Very good. Home and in the kitchen. Eggs to stir and fry. Mama, catch the spatula. Flip the eggs high. Hurry, Mama, hurry. Gotta flip, flip, flop. Hungry, hungry, hungry. That's your cue for some...
Bibimbap!
That sounds great!
Rice is on the boil, bubbling in the pot. White and sticky lickety, steaming good and hot. Hurry, flurry rice, gotta pop, pop, pop. Hungry, 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 here we go for some...
Bibimbap!
Nice reading! Mama's knife is shiny, slicing fast and neat. Garlic and green onions, skinny strips of meat. Hurry, Mama, hurry! Gotta chop, chop, chop! Hungry, very hungry for some...
Bibimbap!
You did it again! Good job! Spinach, sprouts, and carrots, each goes in a pan. Let me pour the water in. Yes, I know I can. Sorry, Mama, sorry. Gotta mop, mop, mop. Hungry in a hurry. For some, your turn.
Bibimbap.
You guys are awesome readers.
Bowls go on the table, big one striped in blue. I help set the glasses out, spoons and chopsticks too. Hurry, family, hurry, gotta hop, hop, hop. Dinner's on the table and it's...
Bibimbap.
Quiet for a moment. Papa says the grace. Everybody says, Amen. A smile on every face. Rice goes in the middle. Egg goes right on top. Mix it. Mix like crazy. Time for... Let's do this together. Ready?
Bibimbap.
You guys are awesome! Great reading!
You're an awesome reader! Let's try and recall some details from the story. Do you remember what was used to make bibimbap? In each of these containers, I have items that were in the story or not in the story. Say, yes! If these were details you remember from the story, say no. If these were not details from the story, get ready. Let's go.
Vegetables. Erasers. Rice. Black Widow. A hot dog. Knife. Spatula. Seashells. A gecko. Eggs.
Alright, boys and girls, our time is up. I had so much fun reading Bibimbap with you, but now it's time for Mrs. Pegarito to hip hip hop out of here. Don't forget that reading will take you on many adventures and show you places all around the world. so don't stop reading. I'll see you next time on PBS University. Bye! Casalelia! That's how we say hello in Panapan. Welcome back to PBS University, boys and girls. I'm Mrs. Pegarito, and I'll be filling in for your first and second grade math lesson. Today, we have something special planned. We're going to the Valley of the Ladi. Have you ever been to the Valley of the Ladi Adventure Park? You can discover many interesting things here. But it would be best to log down what you see so you can tell someone all about it. We can keep track of what we see by creating a pictograph. In this lesson, I can define pictograph. I can create a pictograph. But what exactly is a pictograph? A pictograph is a chart that uses pictures or symbols to represent data. Ooh, data. That's an awesome word. Data is a collection of information including numbers. So when we want to count many things, we can use a pictograph that can help us look back on what we've counted. Hey, look here! This is a pictograph. It has pictures that represent what we can see at the Valley of the Ladi. Check it out! Come on, let's collect some data! Wow! Cool Ladi stones. How many Ladis do you see? Let's count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And there's one hiding. 6. There are 6 Ladi stones. Let's record that in our pictograph. 6 Ladi stones. What else can we find at the Valley of the Ladi Adventure Park? Ooh, what beautiful paintings! How many paintings do you see? Sixteen? Let's record that number in our pictograph. Here we go. There are 16 paintings. What other cool things can we discover? Oh, right! At the Valley of the Ladi, we learned how to open a coconut. Here's Mr. Ernest. He's trying the coconut milk. Mmm! How many pieces of the coconut shell do you see? 1, 2. Let's record that number. There are 2 coconut shells. Hey, I know someone who likes coconut. How many goats are here? 1, 2. There are 2 goats at the Valley of the Ladi. I see someone else who's hungry. I think this rooster is looking for some food. Would you want some coconut? How many roosters are there? 1. 1 rooster. I don't think these guys like coconut. These crabs are really enjoying that slice of bread. How many crabs do you see here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There are 5 crabs. Hey, Hey, there's Miss Cruz. Hi, Miss Cruz. Ooh, she's riding on a carabao. Say hi to Miss Cruz and say hi to Laddie the carabao. How many carabaos do you see? One. Let's record that number. Now we can record our data. Do you remember how many roosters we saw? We saw one rooster. How many goats did we see? Two goats. How many crabs were eating bread? One, two, three, four, five crabs. And how many carabaos was Miss Cruz riding? Right, one carabao. Let's look at our pictograph. Wow, how many animals did we see all together? Let's count them. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. We saw nine animals at the Valley of the Ladi. You guys are awesome at collecting data, and you made a great pictograph. It helps us to record a collection of really cool information. And you helped me make a cool pictograph. Now we can tell all our friends about what we saw at the Valley of the Ladi. All right, boys and girls, I hope you had a lot of fun today learning about pictographs and recording all the cool things we saw at the Valley of the Ladi. This is Mrs. Pegarito, your math teacher, saying goodbye. I'll see you next time on PBS University. Adios!
Konnichiwa, boys and girls. Konnichiwa is hello in Japanese. Say that with me. Konnichiwa. Konnichiwa and welcome back to PBS University. I'm Miss Valencia, your first and second grade science teacher. Last season, we learned so much in our science class, right? We learned a bit about genetics, we learned about some honeybees, we learned about plants and how they grow and how their seeds travel. We also learned how to think like a scientist. Now, for today's episode, boys and girls, do you know what we are going to talk about? Okay, let's just imagine ourselves. Not in our house, but beyond our homes. No, not your backyard. We are going to go beyond your backyard. No, not your neighbor's front yard or their backyard. Not even the village. Not even, oh my gosh, it's just so mind-blowing what we are going to talk about in today's lesson here at PBS University for first to second grade science. We are going to talk about the solar system. And we are going to learn about the eight major planets in the solar system. We're also going to learn how to memorize them in order. But first, we need to learn, what is a solar system? The solar system is made up of the sun and all of the smaller objects that move around it. The solar system has eight major planets. So, everything in our solar system revolves or orbits around one thing. Does anyone know what I'm talking about? Some hints. It is a huge ball that gives off heat and light. Correct, it's the sun. everything in our solar system revolves around the sun. So, with that being said, the planet closest to the sun is Mercury. Mercury is not only the planet closest to the sun, but it is also the smallest planet. The planet after Mercury is Venus. Venus is one of the brightest planets. Not only is it one of the brightest planets in the solar system, but it is also considered to be Earth's twin because Earth and Venus are almost the same size and they are made up of the same rocky material. So we know that we have the sun, and then we have Mercury. After Mercury, it's Venus, but what's the third planet? I'll give you a hint. It's something closer to home. In fact, it is your home. Whoa, did you say Earth? Great job, boys and girls, or hold on. I'm going to correct myself and say, great job, astronomers. All right, so Mercury, Venus, Earth, we're at the fourth planet now. Any guesses as to what it might be? It's Mars. Mars is also known as the red planet. And it's very cold and dry. All right. Moving on to the fifth planet. The fifth planet is Jupiter, and Jupiter is actually the hugest planet from the sun. But although Jupiter is so huge, it actually spins pretty fast, faster than the other planets. Saturn, which is also known as Lord of the Rings, is the sixth planet from the sun. The seventh planet from the sun is Uranus, which is also the third largest planet. The eighth planet from the sun is Neptune. Some astronomers consider Neptune to be the twin of Uranus. It's so cool how we all know what the eight major planets are, but how are we going to memorize them in order? I mean, I can try to make a song, but I'm not the best singer. I can make a dance, but how is that going to help me memorize it if I don't have a song? What's that? Did you say that you made a mnemonic? Great idea, astronomers. Now, let me try making a mnemonic for the eight major planets in order, and I'm gonna try to make it a little bit more personal so it's easier to remember. This is what I came up with. Miss Valencia eats mainly jackfruit snacks using napkins. I think that works. Miss Valencia eats mainly jackfruit snacks using napkins. Do you think it works, boys and girls? It does. It matches what the eight major planets are in order. Yes! What about your mnemonic? What's your mnemonic like? That's very creative, astronomers. Now, everyone, go ahead and kiss your brain. Because you all did such an excellent job, astronomers. I'll see you back next week here at PBS University. Bye, boys and girls. Take care. Be safe.
Hafidei students, welcome to PBS University. My name is John Fernandez, and I'm the superintendent of the Guam Department of Education. These PBS University lessons are made to help you to continue learning. The teachers here prepared fun lessons on science, character education, math, English, and more, and they made it for you, the students of Guam. We're very grateful to them for their instruction. We're also thankful for you students, parents, and guardians who are watching. Remember, stay safe and healthy, and we'll see you soon in the next school year. Thank you.
Mogadven. Mogadven means hi or hello in Yapese. Can you say Mogadven? Mogadven. Hi. Hi, boys and girls. I'm Mrs. Guerrero, and I'm here to teach you social studies today for first and second grade. Are you ready to learn? Me too. But first, let's read our I can statement.
I can discuss and identify different government officials and their jobs. Do you see two big words, boys and girls? There they are, government officials.
Government officials are the people that make decisions in our government. Yes, they make big decisions and small decisions, but all these decisions affect our lives. And today we're going to talk about a few of our government officials. First off, we'll talk about the president and the vice president. Did you know that the president is the leader of our country? The whole country of the United States, including our island of Guam. He's also the commander-in-chief of our armed forces. That's the military. That includes the Army, the Navy, the Air Force. And our vice president, well, her duty is to take over office if the president is unable to be there. She's like the substitute teacher that comes in if your teacher is going to be absent that day. And over here, this is where they work. It's called the White House, and it's in Washington, D.C. Yep, cool, huh? And do you know the names of our current president and vice president? Yes, that's President Biden and Vice President Harris. Now let's talk about the governor and the lieutenant governor. The governor is the leader of our island. One of her biggest jobs is getting to choose who will manage an important part of the government. For example, she gets to choose who the chief of police or who the chief of the fire department will be. And our lieutenant governor, well, he will step into office if the governor is unable to be there. And over here, this is where they work. It's called the Governor Ricardo J. Berdalio Complex, and it's in Adelupe. Do you know the names of our governor and lieutenant governor? Well, their names are Governor Leon Guerrero and Lieutenant Governor Tenorio. Up next, we have our senators. Did you know that we have 15 senators here on Guam? They meet and they debate and vote on the laws that we should have here to keep us safe. An example of a law that they vote on is how fast our car should go on the road. And this is where they work here on Guam. It's called the Guam Congress Building in Hagatnya. Now let's talk about our mayors and vice mayors. Have you seen your mayor or vice mayor driving around your village? Well, they do that to make sure that your village is a safe place to live and play. In order to do that, sometimes they work with police officers or firefighters or even teachers. And our vice mayors, well, they'll step in for the mayor if he or she is unable to be there.
Did you know that we have 19 mayors and 7 vice mayors?
I hope you are listening very carefully, boys and girls, because now we're going to play a game. Would you like to play a game? Me too.
Hi, boys and girls, and welcome to a new trivia challenge called Who's That Government Official? I'm your host, Mr. John, and starting off with the first question, who helps make our cities, towns, or villages a safe place to live and play? An astronaut, the president, or the mayor?
Mayor.
Good job, you got it correct. It's the mayor. Second question, who is in charge of the armed forces of our country? The president, the governor, or a teacher?
The president.
Ding, 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 you got it correct. It's the president. Wow, already you're awesome. Third question, who acts as mayor if the mayor is unable to be in office? A fidget cube, the vice mayor, or the lieutenant governor?
Vice mayor.
Ding, 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 you got it correct. It's the vice mayor. Fourth question, who is the leader of a state, territory, or island? The mayor, a cat, or the governor?
Governor.
Ding, 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 you got it correct. It's the governor. Good job, you're doing great. Next question, whose duty is it to act as president if the president is absent from their office? The vice president, a nurse, or the senator?
Vice president.
Ding, 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 you got it correct. It's the vice president. Next question, who helps make laws like how fast cars should go on the road? The vice mayor, the senator, or a horse?
A senator.
Ding, 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 you got it correct. It's the senator. Okay, last question, here we go. Who fills in for the governor if the governor is unable to be there? The mayor, the lieutenant governor, or a sandwich?
Lieutenant governor.
Ding, 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 you got it correct. It's the lieutenant governor. Congratulations, you're all winners. Thanks for playing, and be sure to join us next time on
Who's That Government Official?
Yay! A round of applause for everyone. You did such a great job today, boys and girls. I'm glad you were listening very carefully. Now, can you name all the government officials that we talked about today? We have the president, the vice president, the governor, lieutenant governor, the senators, mayors, and vice mayors. Great job! Now, would you like to be a government official when you grow up? Yeah, that would be awesome! Well, that's all the time I have today. I'm so glad you can join me and learn with me. But before you go, make sure you always work hard and be kind, boys and girls. And I'll see you next time. Bye!
Konnichiwa, friends! Did you know that konnichiwa is how you say hello in Japanese? Can you say it with me? Konnichiwa! Excellent! Welcome to PBS University. I am so happy that you're joining me today. My name is Mr. Nicholas, and this season I'm going to be your character education teacher for first and second grade. For the next few episodes, we are going to be talking about something very important and something that each and every one of us has. Can you guess what we're going to be talking about? Well, this was a tricky one, but if you guessed emotions, you are absolutely correct. For this episode, we are going to be talking about an emotion that I mentioned earlier. Let's rewind and hear it again. Welcome to PBS University. I am so happy that you're joining me today. Did you hear what emotion we're going to be talking about today? Did you say happy? Absolutely. Today, we are going to be talking about happiness. We're going to be reading The Giving Tree by Shel Silverstein.
Once there was a tree, and she loved a little boy. And every day, the boy would come, and he would gather her leaves and make them into crowns and play king of the forest. He would climb up her trunk and swing from her branches and eat apples. And they would play hide and go seek. And when he was tired, he would sleep in her shade. And the boy loved the tree very much. And the tree was happy. But time went by, and the boy grew older, and the tree was often alone. Then one day the boy came to the tree, and the tree said, "Come, boy, come and climb up my trunk and swing from my branches and eat apples and play in my shade and be happy." "I am too big to climb and play," said the boy. "I want to buy things and have fun. I want some money. Can you give me some money?" "I'm sorry," said the tree, "but I have no money. I have only leaves and apples. Take my apples, boy, and sell them in the city. Then you will have money and you will be happy." And so the boy climbed up the tree and gathered her apples and carried them away. And the tree was happy. But the boy stayed away for a long time, and the tree was sad. And then one day the boy came back, and the tree shook with joy. And she said, "Come, boy, climb up my trunk and swing from my branches and be happy."
"I am too busy to climb trees," said the boy. "I want a house to keep me warm," he said. "I want a wife and I want children, and so I need a house. Can you give me a house?"
"I have no house," said the tree. "The forest is my house, but you may cut off my branches and build a house. Then you will be happy." And so the boy cut off her branches and carried them away to build his house. And the tree was happy. But the boy stayed away for a long time, and when he came back, the tree was so happy she could barely speak. "Come, boy," she whispered. "Come and play."
"I am too old and sad to play," said the boy. "I want a boat that will take me far away from here. Can you give me a boat?"
"Cut down my trunk and make a boat," said the tree. "Then you can sail away and be happy." And so the boy cut down her trunk and made a boat and sailed away. And the tree was happy, but not really. And after a long time, the boy came back again. "I am sorry, boy," said the tree, "but I have nothing left to give you. My apples are gone."
"My teeth are too weak for apples," said the boy.
"My branches are gone," said the tree. "You cannot swing on them."
"I am too old to swing on branches," said the boy.
"My trunk is gone," said the tree. "You cannot climb."
"I am too tired to climb," said the boy.
"I am sorry," sighed the tree. "I wish that I could give you something, but I have nothing left. I am just an old stump. I am sorry."
"I don't need very much now," said the boy. "Just a quiet place to sit and rest. I am very tired."
"Well," said the tree, straightening herself up as much as she could. "Well, an old stump is good for sitting and resting. Come, boy, sit down. Sit down and rest." And the boy did. And the tree was happy. The end.
Wow, great listening, friends. Now, I want us to talk about what made the characters happy in The Giving Tree. Let's think about when the boy was little. What made him happy? Right. All he wanted to do was spend time with the tree, swinging in the branches, playing in the leaves, and just hanging out. But what happens when the boy started to get older? Right. Then the boy started wanting more things to be happy. He wanted apples to make money. He wanted the branches to build a house. He wanted the trunk to build a boat. What about the tree? What made the tree happy? Exactly. Just hanging out with the boy and the boy coming to visit and spending time with the tree made the tree so happy. Now, I want us to remember that although getting new things and having things is nice sometimes, we shouldn't make it the only things that make us happy. Remember, happiness comes from inside of us. So we're not going to be miserable if we don't get the new phone or the new gadget, and we're not going to throw a fit to our parents and say, "I'm so angry, I'm so sad." Right? Because happiness is more than that. Sometimes happiness isn't the game that you're playing, but the friend that you're playing it with. Sometimes it's not that new swimming pool, but the experience of hanging out with your friends and your family. I am so glad that you were able to join me today. I look forward to seeing you next week. Bye, friends!
I didn't know you're waiting for Senora. Half a day. Casalelia, my PBS University friends. Casalelia means hello in Pompeian. Yes. And guess what? Senora went to Pompeii a while back with some of my friends. It's so beautiful. The ocean is so clean, and there's a lot of crab. Do you like crab? Yes. And guess who I saw there? I saw the high chief. It's called in CHamoru Magatlahi. It's so beautiful. Everybody in Pompeii is Familia, family. I have a surprise for you. Are you ready? Kolisoha? Great, I am. I can't wait. Are you ready for our lesson? Oh yes, great job, I am ready. We're going to learn three new words today in CHamoru. It's all about Familia. Can you say Familia? Yes, Familia. Oh, wait, hold on. Somebody said Panene. Yes, Panene means Familia in Pompeii. Yeah, great job. Okay, Familia means family. Repeat after me. Familia, get ready. Familia. Again, Familia. Yes, great job, awesome. Do you have a big Familia? Oh, great, 10? Awesome, my Familia is very small. I have my Nana, Tata, and Nanny. Who has three Familias? We have the same, my three Familia. So let's learn some words today. Say Nana. Nana. Again, Nana. Can you say Nana in your language? Awesome! I am so excited! Our next person in our Familia is Tata. Tata. Great job! Awesome! High five! And then our last
person in my Familia is Nanny. Again, Nanny. Say Nanny. Awesome. High five. Okay, let's go over our Familia. Get ready. The first one is, what did I hear? Tata. Great job. And then the second one in our Familia? Yes, Nada. And the third one is Nanny. So here, Nana, Tata, Nanny.
So what did we learn today?
Oh yes, about our Familia. Well, now we're going to learn how to spell those words. Are you ready? ¿Co esta listo, ha? I am. Awesome. The first word is Nana. Nana. Ne, a, ne, a. Again, Nana. Ne, a, ne, a. What is the word? Yes, Nana. The next word is Tata. Listen to Senora. Tata. Te, a, te, a. Again, te, a, te, a. What is that word? Yes, Tata. Our last word is Nanny. Ne, e, ne, e. Again, ne, e, ne, e. What is that word? Yes, I'm so excited. What was that girl's Nanny? Let's recap again. In our Familia, we have, oh yes, Tata. Again, yes, Tata. And what else? Oh yes, Nana. And Nanny. Don't forget Nanny. Let me see if you can say it all by yourself. Great job! So now that you learn all those words, the Familia words, I'm gonna teach you a song. But before I teach you the song, I'd like you to learn two words. Yes, listen and watch. Guma, guma, guma means house. Guma means house. And mangi, mangi means where. Again, mangi means where. So the song is, listen. Mangi sinana gagi gigi ma. Okay, can we do it all together? Get ready. Mangi sinana gagi gigi ma. Mangi sitata gagi gigi ma. Mangi sineni gagi gigi ma. One more time. Let's make it faster this time. Get ready. Mangi sinana gagi gigi ma. Mangi sitata gagi gigi ma. Mangi sineni gagi gigi ma. High five. Awesome. You did great. Great job, boys and girls. Family teaches us so many things in life. To be kind, to be respectful, to be forgiving, and also the most important thing is love, which means guayza. Who guayza, huh, boys and girls? Little things like you can make big things happen for the world. Be safe, be responsible. Adios!
God save our gracious queen, long live our noble queen, God save the queen. Hi everyone, this is Mr. Ernest Ochoco, boop, with another Fast Fun Fact. And today I was singing the British National Anthem. Do you know why? Oh, well, let me tell you why, because I don't think you can guess that. Well, it's because of the person that we are going to talk about today, John Thomas Smith. In 1797, he created something called the Rule of Thirds, right? The Rule of Thirds. thirds. That's 3RDS right there. And the rule of thirds is really cool because you can use it in film and in taking pictures so that you can use the best places in the frame. Yeah, this is called the frame. In the frame, and make sure that certain things in your pictures or in your film are more important. Mm-hmm. So let's see some examples from our friend Emmy.
Thank you, Mr. Ochoco. Hi, kids. Now we can demonstrate how we can use the rule of thirds. First, we're going to need a subject. Let me think. How about our friend, Panda? So, Panda, can you help me with the rule of thirds?
Okay.
So, if I want to make you look important in a picture, where should I put you?
How about in the really, really top corner? Super, super high. Up, 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 up. Nope, that doesn't work. How about on the other side? Oh, no, that doesn't work either. Okay, how about on the third? Right third. Right there. I look so super important because I'm in the imaginary line that goes up and then down. So put me up and higher. There we go. I'm on the right third.
Well, Panda, what if I want to look important in the picture too?
Maybe you can go on the other side, on the left third.
Like right here?
Yes, that's where the line that goes up and down should be for the left third.
Wow, thank you so much, Panda.
Thank you, I had so much fun.
Well, kids, I hope you learned something about taking great pictures.
Yeah, and I hope you can do this at home.
Say bye, Panda.
Bye, bye, kids.
Bye, kids.
I hope you learned something about the rule of thirds with our friend Emmy and Panda. This is Mr. Ochoco, boop, with another Fast Fun Fact. Bye, everyone.
Hafide students, I'm Lieutenant Governor Josh Tenorio. For more than a year now, you all have continued to wash your hands and watch your distance from others, and you've done a really great job wearing your masks. We know your parents and guardians have helped you to make these changes to keep yourself and your community safe. As Governor Leon Guerrero said, we are happy you are here. We want you to continue to learn and sharpen your skills with the help of PBS University. This program is the result of a collaborative effort. We couldn't do it alone. I'd like to thank the teachers and support staff of the Guam Department of Education and PBS Guam for their work and their commitment to our students. I'd also like to thank you, students, for participating at home. To your parents, I'd like to thank you for taking an active role in your child's education. We are all eager to return to a time when all of us can share and study together in person. Until then, we hope you learned something new from this PBS University instruction.